I'm Nathan Milford. I'm the U.S. Operations Manager with Outbrain, and I'm going to talk a little bit about Cassandra operations. But before I start, how many people in this room actually would, by show of hands, would actually describe themselves as an ops person? All right, 2, 4, 6, 8. All right, cool. So you're my people. And everyone else, I'm assuming you're recruiters, developers, or developers who are drug into having to deal with ops. From smaller startups. This talk, actually, I should silence my phone. Last time I did this talk, I lost a data center, so that was not awesome. But what was awesome was I was able to redirect traffic away from it until I finished the talk. But this talk was originally given, like 6 months or something like that ago, maybe not even that long ago, at the League of Professional Sysadministrators meetup. Which is a fantastic organization, and those of you who are ops folks, I highly recommend you go to their meetups. But that being said, this talk is really tuned towards people who may not necessarily have run Cassandra. It was mostly for enterprise admins, so a lot of it's going to be review, a lot of it's going to be sort of describing mechanisms, and then the second half of the talk is actually going to be more along the lines of actual operational duties and stuff. And all this is for 0.8, which is what I run right now. I'm really excited about 1.0, but haven't gotten there yet. So let's get started. Does anyone here not run Cassandra or not know what Cassandra is? That's what I thought. So I don't need to really go over the slide because we all know it's a columnar database and we all know what a columnar database is and why it's great and where Cassandra came from, and based off the Facebook discussion during the keynote earlier, we know where it started. Whole bunch of people use it, a whole bunch more people than that, since I made this deck quite a while ago. I don't need to convince you guys that Cassandra is the epic hotness. If you want to get a little support, you can give these guys money, or bribe them with liquor, which is what we did last night. And then there are books, by the way, and that was brought up earlier. The Cassandra High Performance Cookbook was written by Ed, who's actually speaking in the other room. And we're having a little bit of a competition, because Ed's a very good friend of mine. So what I want us all to do is clap really, really loudly and cheer for me, so loud that they can hear it over there, so that I can... That's going to be great. We're going to do a couple more of those randomly. And that'll wake everybody up, because a lot of this is going to be review for many of you. At Cassandra, we're a content recommendation service. We're on a whole boatload of the world's biggest sites, CNN, Fox News, Slate, USA Today. And we're probably one of the most successful startups that I work for right now. And probably one of the most successful startups you don't know. Our widget actually loads, and that's it in the bottom corner, without any branding. So we're on a lot of sites. And you almost certainly have clicked on one of our links that have been served out of Cassandra. We rock about 30 billion impressions, give or take a couple billion a month, depending on what month it is and what budgets are at and what kind of traffic people are getting and who has died and what celebrity is in rehab. It's amazing how much money you make in content off of, you know, tragedy. Which comes out to be about a billion a day, more or less. And almost all of that is served via Cassandra, but it's not our own main, or it's not our only data store. We use it for a sort of semi-persistent storage of recommendations. We're dumping them in there. We keep about 3 days worth in there, and then they roll out. I'm really excited about TTLs, and I need to work with our dev team, which is all in Israel, about implementing those. And we actually use real hardware. We don't really live in EC2 or anything like that. My boss, who actually had to go to a meeting right now, and he's not in the room, is a huge, a detractor of Amazon. So we don't get to play with it too much. We've got 14 nodes, which is a respectable cluster. We're not huge. We don't have 288 like Amazon, Netflix likes to spawn every once in a while for fun. And we're using 8. I'm going to upgrade to 1, hopefully, in a couple weeks, probably in the new year. We use Hector. The original guy who started working on Hector works for us. He used to work for us, works for us part-time. And actually, our unreplicated data set is actually the same size as our regular MySQL data set. which is spread out across about, I don't know, I'd say we've got about somewhere between two and three dozen MySQL nodes. As an ops guy, I don't know if a lot of you have to deal with MySQL, and it's fantastic, and it's very fantastic at what it does, but a lot of data doesn't necessarily need to live in MySQL. And I manage replication, or I'm part of a team that manages replication and repair and stuff of that, that whole MySQL cluster across three data centers. So the replication ease of use in Cassandra is probably the main reason we use it. On top of that, it rocks in so many other ways. I don't think I need to go much more over this slide. This is our kind of basic use case, and it's simplified, and there are other data stores, but we're serving out of Tomcat. It's actually behind HA proxy. And then Tomcat grabs recs out of Memcache, which if we got a little bit more disciplined about using Cassandra, we wouldn't necessarily need, because we could use the built-in row cache and stuff like that. Logs are shipped via Flume, which is not really true right now because they're doing a rewrite of Flume, and I really want to wait to put it into production until it's done. And that stuff gets pushed back into Hadoop and Hive, but it's also put into Solr and a couple other standalone processes. We've got about two dozen different algorithms for organic and paid content. And then once all of those recommendations are packaged based off of the different algorithms and sources for those algorithms, they're dumped into Cassandra, where they live and they're sourced by our cache warmer, which floats them up into Memcache. That's sort of our basic use case. And we're looking at doing a lot more things. We have like a big document mapping table, which is a perfect use case for Cassandra, where you just have a key and then actually a URL. So I hope to move that over there eventually. I'm gonna get into some of the, for an ops guy, some of the underlying mechanisms that makes Cassandra do most of your job for you and deal with repair and replication. But most of what you need to do is just pretty much install it, define a seed, set a few strategies, and let it go, and then it's all tuning after that. It's really friendly for ops guys. I'm not a DBA. I don't have a computer science degree. I'm a film major. And I know, right? In another life, I would be filming the guy giving this talk. How's it going? Anyway, so after that, it's all tweaking. So there's not a whole lot to it for an ops guy, and that's why I love it. I don't get a lot of calls about it. It doesn't break that often for us. I spend an inordinately, well, I just spend a greater amount of time dealing with other data stores. All right, so what's so great about Cassandra? I bet you all know these things. There's the middle administration, which I've spoken highly of. There's no single point of failure. There's no like name node or master for any particular replica, per se. It scales horizontally. You can just keep throwing nodes at it, as Netflix proved. Writes are durable, and I'll talk about how that's achieved. Consistency is tunable as needed, and reads or writes, which is a big deal. And actually, I just saw, I don't know if any of you guys are on Twitter and you follow DevOps Borat. He tweeted yesterday, you either have eventual consistency delay today or eventual website tomorrow, which I'm a big fan of DevOps Borat. Schema's flexible and handles failure gracefully. The init script pretty much just kills it. You know, it's like you can pull a plug and that's the same thing as doing hitting the init script. And replication is easy, and that's the big deal for my use case because I have to run it over two data centers. So this is a data model. I'm sure most of you are familiar with it, so I won't go too deep. And I know there's another talk, I think immediately after me, I think about data modeling. This is kind of a hacked up way of thinking about it for an ops guy, and it's not totally correct, and I know I'm gonna get beaten to submission later by people who know better than I knew, but you can sort of think of a key space as a sort of a database, and a column family as sort of a table, and a column is sort of the basic unit, and as a key, a value, and a timestamp. And then like a row is a smattering of column data. And for an ops guy, understanding how rows are sort of represented and put together is actually more important, mostly because you gotta think about in terms of fat rows and skinny rows, and it plays into how you tune your caching and stuff, which is, as Jonathan mentioned earlier, kind of a dark art. So you've got it installed, which is pretty easy and straightforward to do. How does Cassandra work without a name node or anything like that? It uses a gossip protocol, which routes requests, checks on the status of other guys, deals with the failure, I guess it works with the FI accrual failure detector, which I never thought I'd be able to say out loud and have people nod along like, oh, I know what that is. And I bet you thought you'd never heard of an ops guy who knew what it was too. So like the first thing you generally need to do is set your seed, and after that the cluster sort of self-assembles. So now that you've got this cluster and you need to define how to divide your data up on it, and you choose a partitioning strategy. The most common one is a random partitioner. There's a couple others, and for most use cases, you're not gonna go near them. The most common is random partitioner, and it's just gonna do an MD5 of the key and then place it in a distributed hash table, like that. So generally, you talk about the ring in Cassandra, and that's my very special representation of it. Each individual node is given an initial token from 0 to 1 to the 27th power, which is such a big number that you can't easily represent it in JavaScript, which I found. And you need to use the bigint.js library. And I'm not a really wildly good developer, so don't ask me to get into why that is. So what happens is when you divide up your data based off of the MD5, each one of those individual guys has an initial token. You write data. The MD5 matches the range of that token to the next node, and the primary replica lives on that node. Yeah, that's pretty straightforward. I tried to write a implementation of the token calculator in JavaScript, and it didn't work. But my brother-in-law wrote one for me in PHP that works a lot better. There it is if you need it. if you can't write it in Python in three lines. So now that you've decided how you're gonna sort of partition your data up, Cassandra sort of needs to know about what your network looks like. And it uses a little piece of software called a snitch. I'm one of the guys who runs the Cassandra NYC meetup group. And a while ago, Eric Tam, who I don't know if he's here or not. Hey, there he is. He gave a really fantastic talk about network topology strategy, which I'll talk about in a minute. But he did a really concise and clear explanation of diving through the different pluggable components here. So if you can't get a hold of one of the DataStax guy, he knows what he's talking about. And he's fantastically articulate, much more than I am. So you've got your simple snitch, and it's pretty straightforward. You've got your rack inferring snitch, which most of you are probably from startups, and so you probably don't have the luxury of thinking too far ahead about what your infrastructure is going to look like to actually think of having an IP address scheme that maps to racks and like data centers. I don't have that. So I use the property file snitch, which there's a file in the etsy Cassandra conf directory where you can explicitly define what IP address of what node goes to what data center and rack. And it's a truly arbitrary value. I use, IP address NYDC1 rack 1, but you can use, IP address Pluto Princess Fun Pants. And that could be the name of your rack if you wanted to. And then there's the EC2 snitch, which I'll get into a little bit. I'm not authority on those matters. So now that you've decided what your topology looks like and you know where your first replica is going to go, you're going to decide the strategy you're going to use to define where the other replicas go. There used to be an older one that we still use that I'm hoping to move to NTS, but first there's simple strategy, which is perfectly fine if you're in a single data center setup. Just places the replicas in the adjacent nodes. Network topology strategy, which Eric is the master of, is used with a property file snitch, and it allows you to have a more finer grain control over where your replicas are going. And this actually, when you're defining your schema, you can do something like strategy options equals New York 2 replicas, LA 2 replicas, or 1 or whatever. And I imagine that syntax has changed, because I think I wrote this when I was at 0.7, and I think they've updated it, and you can do it all through CQL or whatever. So this is all seeming familiar. So getting your data into Cassandra used to be done mostly through Thrift, and then you'd wrap that in an API, and you'd use Hector or PyCassa or whatever. And that's all fine and good. We use Hector. But now we have SQL. I have trouble saying SQL versus CQL. And JDBC. And there are whole other sessions on that, so I won't go deep in it, but it looks like SQL. And another thing you need to notice is that all nodes are created equal since there's no master node. So whatever node you happen to connect to and start a session with sort of coordinates reads and writes for your connection. So you can actually, you know, get more concurrent or parallel and talk to all your nodes from different clients and, you know, push a lot of data in there. Connection pooling sometimes is done in the framework. Sometimes it's done through round-robin DNS, and if you're, you know, OPSI, you can throw it in HA proxy. You don't necessarily need to do that. If you're defining your pool of, like right now we've got seven nodes in our New York cluster, or the New York half of our cluster, and we've actually only, and sadly I just discovered this because I don't manage that side of things, we've only got three nodes defined for the connection pool in Hector. And then I started noticing that these three nodes are actually quite a bit more heavier loaded than the other ones. And I'm like, why is that? And it, I actually found out to be. So you could actually just create like a virtual IP or something like that for HA proxy, and then it can load balance between them or something like that. You don't necessarily have to use HA proxy, but if you have if you explicitly define, and this is Hector specific, and I think Nate McCall and some of the other guys could be a little bit more thorough in explaining it than I could. But if you explicitly define statically different nodes, if one of them's down, it's going to try to hit that and then move on to the next one. Whereas HA proxy is only going to expose that node if it's responding to its check. Cool. I almost sounded like I knew what I was talking about. All right, so tunable consistency. It's difficult to keep things consistent when you're in the same rack across switches, let alone when you're across continents. You know, and you usually have to make the trade-off, and I'm sure you've all heard of the CAP theorem. Anyone not heard of the CAP theorem? Do I need to go into it? Fantastic. So Cassandra actually focuses on availability and partition tolerance over consistency, and there's all that sort of traditional FUD, I actually said FUD aloud, fear, uncertainty, and doubt of eventual consistency. And it's actually tunable, and I usually like to correct people on that, because that's one of the awesome things about Cassandra. It's so awesome that we're gonna let Ed Capriello know how awesome tunable consistency is. I'm in your debt. So you actually get to make the trade-off between latency and, you know, consistency. So you get to define what's more important. So when you're actually writing your queries for reads and writes, you can choose of all of these magical options what's more important to you. We almost do everything at one because we're just putting in, you know, not so mission critical recommendations that can easily get recalculated or whatever. So it's not that big of a deal for us, but these are all the options. They're all fantastic, and I could go into them in deeper detail, but the slide sort of says whatever it needs to say, and I'm not gonna go too much deeper. So the Cassandra write path, is that write or read? I did write first. The Cassandra write path, and this is sort of the mechanism it uses to keep writes durable, is, you know, the first part of a write is it's gonna identify what node in the cluster that write should be written to. Then it's gonna write it to the commit log. The commit log is analogous to the write ahead log in HBase, or it's kind of like a MySQL bin log. It's being written sequentially. It's trying to minimize random IO. And I just learned today, like most of you, that it's a single threaded process that they're going to improve in 1.1. which I don't have any problems with it right now, but great looking out, guys. And then at the same time, data is written to a memtable, which is just up in memory. It's a structure that represents your data. And as you're writing more and more of these memtables, eventually they get flushed to disk as SS tables. Which are these immutable files that contain your data. And over time, more and more of these files accumulate, and you need to do a compaction, which I'll talk about a little bit later. But if you pull the plug and you bring your node back up, it's going to read through the commit log, and you know, you're not going to lose data, which is pretty flippin' awesome. But I won't make you clap for that. Oh, you actually have a question. It's having consequences of using solid state versus spindle disks. We use spindle disks, and I talk about my disk config later. We actually moved from Tokyo Tyrant on SSDs over to Cassandra on a RAID array, and we find that, you know, for our use case, it performs better. But I don't know too much deep about it because I've never really used Cassandra on SSDs. So I've never really looked too deep on it. What I did find is we used Dell hardware. So when we used OCZ Vertex EX drives, which were the time we were using it, were the best in the market. They had the garbage collection, the wear leveling, and all the sort of nice trim support and all that. We would have problems in Dell servers with third-party drives freezing up. And I think it was because they ran a little hot, and then the perk would reject them. But that's as far as I know. As far as Cassandra specific, let me get through the reading slide and then I'll answer more questions. Anyway, so Cassandra identifies the node that something needs to be written to. First, it checks the Bloom filter, which is this sort of, and I'm a film guy, so I'm not supposed to know what a Bloom filter is. But it's this little filter that you hit and it tells you whether or not the data is on that node, and it can give you a false positive. So worst case scenario, it has to, you know, burn a couple more milliseconds or microseconds or whatever to actually go further down and search for that data. But it's absolutely impossible to get a false negative. So there's no situation where it says, well, the data's not here, I don't know what you're talking about. So it actually, it saves quite a bit of time. It's a nice little feature. Then it checks the index, and the index tells us which SS table file and how far into the file to look for that. And that's pretty much all for that slide. Distributed deletes. Like I said, keeping things consistent is difficult, and keeping deletes in a distributed system is actually difficult, and especially when SS tables are immutable. So what we do is we tombstone them. We mark them for deletion, and the data still until you do a compaction, which clears out the deletes, the data is actually still physically on the server. Until it's cleared out, it's just not able to be read by the API. And it's cleaned out during major compaction when the git merge is made. So compaction. It's a whole new world with pluggable compaction and leveled compaction and stuff like that, which I'm still having trouble wrapping my head around after Jonathan's talk about it. I'm gonna have to ping him later. But when you have enough SS tables built, and this is a configurable item in your config, in your cassandra.yaml, and probably over JMX, you need to actually merge those together. One of the sort of gotchas, once you take like six SS table files and merge them into one, is you invalidate a lot of your file system cache, which will add a little bit more load on the server itself. It's an expensive process, there's lots of garbage collection. Occasionally, I used to have problems, and it's a lot better since 0.7. We've been using it since 0.4, I had an earlier slide, where we'd run into compactions and we'd have big garbage collections. And part of that was due to us not understanding the compaction process well enough, and knowing that we needed twice as much space as we really needed to be able to handle compaction. But it was also due when caching was actually in the heap. Tombstones are discarded during this time. It's a manual or automatic process. There's always little minor compactions going on, which is really nice. And it's pluggable, and there's leveled compaction.
The cache warmer that you guys use to push stuff up to Memcache,
yeah.
Do you guys use that as sort of a disk-based cache warmer as well, as sort of like an indirect side effect? Because like when you GC, you clearly, as you just said, invalidate all the file system caches. I guess that could be made better when the cache warmer goes below that?
No, we don't really work that way. Like right now, the cache warmer, there's my boss right now, and he can talk about the cache warmer a little bit more. Say hi, Ori. The cache warmer is only mostly used for fetching algorithmic like output, or fetching fetching recommendations, package recommendations from different algorithm sources, and then feeding them up into Memcache. So if we crawl a document or something like that, or someone goes to a document and we don't have any recommendations for that document, it'll say, hey, cache warmer, where are my recommendations? I didn't see anything in Memcache. And then what it actually does is it creates something in ActiveMQ. Anyone use ActiveMQ? Anyone feel my pain? No? All right. Actually, I like ActiveMQ when I don't have to restart it. What happens from there is then those messages are sent downstream into all the different sources, Solr, our crawlers, our indexers, and all these different standalone processes, and to things that read and write from Cassandra that we call ads engines. And then, you know, they're dumped into Cassandra. All right, so let me keep moving on before I'll take more outbrain-specific questions afterwards. And this is one of the other really wonderful things I like about Cassandra as a sysadmin, and what makes me super happy, because I don't have to deal with it. I actually, this morning, had a MySQL slave, good old MySQL 13, a very ominous number, have a corruption that after I'm done with this talk, I'm probably gonna go have to fight. But if it were a Cassandra node, how am I doing on time, by the way? Am I okay? Oh, actually, I'm really good. If it were a Cassandra node, you've got all these wonderful mechanisms that are going to deal with data drift, entropy, read repair. Every time you do a read on a quorum or an all level, it's already checking that data anyway, and if it sees discrepancies, it's going to, and I'm not a CS guy, right? It's going to take these things called Merkle trees. And I don't know what a Merkle tree is, but I've always sort of visualized it in my head as each node has a Christmas tree with different ornaments on it, and so they exchange and get the same ornaments. It's a really like silly sophomoric vision, but that's how I visualize it. And they exchange these trees, and then they find out who's missing what data, and then it repairs it. And so repairs can be manual, and it's actually a best practice to actually put a repair in cron for less than the time that you have GC gray seconds plugged into your Cassandra YAML. Otherwise, you can have forgotten deletes, and I can get into that a little bit more later. Another really nice function is when a node is down, it has hinted handoff, which we actually don't use at Cassandra for various reasons, but when a node is down, whatever your node you're writing to, it's gonna spool those writes up to hand off to the Cassandra node when it comes back up, which is fantastic. But there are two caveats to it. One that's fantastic is you don't lose data and writes, but there are two caveats. The first is that even though that data is being written to the cluster, it's in sort of a staging hints place, so it doesn't really play into a quorum or all read. So that's the first one. And the second is that when the node comes back, it can totally get hammered if it's been down for a long time. I think they've actually might have fixed this in 1.0. I'm not entirely sure. Someone could probably, huh? Okay, so 08. So I could probably turn it back on because I'm in 08. So what is it? It's throttled, right? All right, cool.
What about read repairs?
Read repairs?
Yeah,
you can't. Oh, I'm sorry.
No,
thanks, man. Well, no, I mean, like, read repairs are happening all the time, but you still want to schedule, like, a larger repair, because for data that you're not actively reading, data that's not hot, you know, it can still drift. So, next slide. Caching, which I mentioned earlier, we used to have problems with garbage collection and stuff like that because of caching, but if you're using the JNA library, I believe that's the trigger, it's actually, caching is done off heap, which is flipping fantastic, which allows us to reduce our heap size, which makes us less vulnerable to really big garbage collections and junk like that. I like it. So you've got your key cache, and it puts, you know, it's on by default, it puts like 200,000 keys in memory for every column family, and it just keeps the location of where those keys are at. But then you've also got the row cache, which that's where you get the sort of dark art of tuning. Like, we've got a couple really fat rows that are probably not appropriate to put in the cache, but if you've got a bunch of skinny rows, you can be a little bit more wild and try a bunch of different stuff. And in the sort of stack, our stack where we use Memcache, it's not impossible that, you know, if we put our heads together, we would be able to eliminate memcache and actually use the caching mechanism within Cassandra. Rocache is consultant first on a read, and then it goes to the key cache, and then it eventually goes down to, you know, disk. And it requires quite a bit of tuning. All right, so hardware. So now we're up to the ops stuff. So I'm glad like the six of you who are ops sysadmins have bared with me, and all the rest of the devs aren't asleep yet, because it's all stuff that you already know. So RAM, like, we have our nodes are the same hardware profile as our MySQL slaves. 32 gigs, 8 cores, 6 disks in, you know, different RAID configurations. So right now I'm setting my heap size to like 8 gigs. It used to be like 16, but I'm only setting it to 8 now that everything's off heap. And then the rest of that space is used for caching, which is fantastic. CPU, Cassandra's crazy concurrent. So the more cores you throw at it, the more things you can do at the same time, which is fantastic. So like more cores the better. Disk, it's usually better have either 2 sets of disks, 2 spindles or 2 disks, and separate the commit log, which is just writing sequentially, to the data, which is kind of a different read and write access profile, so they don't sort of step on each other's toes. And then network, you know, gig's fine, depends on your use case. I'm sure you could, you know, put a 10 gig interface in there and never use it. But one really cool thing is that you can split up gossip and you can split up data to 2 different networks. So I know a couple people who do that. All right, so EC2. We do not use EC2, and you can ask Ori about that later. He's a big fan. So you're going to have to ask some other people about it more deeply, but from my understanding, and actually Jake made this slide for me. Thanks, Jake. Where you can use the EC2 snitch, and it'll map availability zones to data centers and regions to racks. And it uses NTS, I guess. You know, general best practice, from my understanding, is to avoid EBS because it doesn't deal well with load, I guess. You can ask the guys at Reddit and a couple other places that live in EC2 about that. RAID 0, RAID 11 across ephemeral drives is usually the best practice. And then you replicate across availability zones. And Netflix is doing all sorts of awesome stuff with Cassandra, like leaving Oracle completely for Cassandra, all up in EC2. So that's pretty hot. So installing it, it's very easy. You add the repositories and you yum or apt-get. It's pretty straightforward. It couldn't be any more simpler. We actually do it through Chef, and we've scripted it. You can do it in Puppet. And I actually have no experience, although I just got back from the Op Center talk. Op Center is actually pretty hot, and I actually want to learn more about their packaging and how they deploy it, because I'm probably going to go home after I fix that MySQL 13 and install it. Configuration is in /etc/cassandra/conf. You've got your YAML file, which as of 0.7 was upgraded from a harder to read XML file. And then all your environment stuff, your heap, JMX options and stuff is in the Cassandra EMV. And then you've got your logs, your Cassandra log, your system log that all have all sorts of very important information. All right, so hot tips. Use the Oracle Sun JVM. Most of these are totally ripped off from the wiki, but I actually use them. Use the JNA library so you can interface directly with the disk rather than being abstracted through Java. It increases performance quite a bit, and it lets you do off-heap caching and stuff like that. Don't use auto bootstrap when you're adding nodes, unless you're adding like a perfectly even amount of nodes. You're going from 8 to 16 or something like that, because what auto bootstrap does is it takes the range that is the biggest or the node that owns the most tokens and cuts it in half, and that's a quick way to get a lopsided cluster, which isn't very good. Super columns, which I didn't get into, impose a performance penalty because you're essentially going from a four-dimensional array as how you model your data to a five-dimensional array. Enable the garbage collection logging. It's a simple little thing to do in the environment script. Don't use a large heap. The larger the heap, the bigger the garbage collection. Turn off swap. You don't want Cassandra being swapped out of memory. If you're swapping on a Cassandra node, you're probably not in a very good place to begin with.
About the JVM part. During the sort of the process, we found that A lot less hangs.
Yeah. So I don't understand. What's your question? Or are you just...
Have you tried doing that?
Oh, have I tried...
I just saw the camera guy's head explode.
Not really. I just pretty much use the defaults. I don't get too deep into the like garbage collection tuning. I'll fire up J console every once in a while and watch it sawtooth, as I learned from the inestimable Jake Luciani. But I don't get that deep into tuning the JVM itself. We've been pretty lucky and done pretty well with a lot of the defaults. I missed the last session on the JVM that I think Nate did, so I'm gonna have to watch the video later. So monitoring, which a lot of this is, we started a long time ago, and so we built out our deploy and monitoring stuff and all our operational practices for Cassandra before there was DataStax to make awesome things like OpsCenter. So we started dumping MX4J in the class path and then curling and grepping and awking all that data and dumping it into Nagios. But you can dump it wherever you want or use, you know, OpsCenter. Things that you want to monitor. These are also the basic things. Ideally, you want to monitor everything, right? But stuff that you kind of want to be looking at while you're kind of getting your feet wet and getting used to having a cluster is you want to check all the Java stuff, like heap size. Maybe that's what's doing it. You want to watch garbage collection, IO wait. Row mutation, which is just another term for writes. Compaction information, cache information, and read information. A lot of times, because of at point 8, you don't have that cool 1.0 increase in read performance. Sometimes I'll see writes back up, and I'll show you that. I'll show you an output of the CF or the TP stats of that later. But you know, if you see that your reads are starting to back up, then either upgrade to 1.0 and maybe you won't have that problem, or maybe you need to remodel your data because it's not efficient, or maybe you actually need to add more nodes, or you know, change your pattern. So here's a couple actual operational things that you can do in your own cluster that most of these are actually automated in DataStax product. Adding a node. So when you add a node, you calculate the new token of that node, or of all the nodes. So if you go from like 6 to 7, you gotta shift a bunch of them over. And then you set the correct initial token on the new node. You bring it up, it bootstraps, it gets all of the data from its neighbors that it now owns. And then one by one, you do a node tool move until they're all evenly displaced. You know, it's not that expensive, but it's a little time consuming and you gotta nanny it a little bit. And they've actually automated that in the, I just learned, in the op center. Removing a node, there are two different ways you can do it. You can do a decommission, which is kind of easier on the cluster as a whole. It'll slowly start giving up its data and then retire itself, versus a remove, which is just like pulling the plug and removing out, and that puts a little bit more stress on the adjoining nodes to fill in the gap. Replacing a node, I mean, you just give the new node the same IP address and the same initial token. It comes up, it's got no data, you run a read repair, and it says, hey, I'm this guy, I own this, and then all of the other nodes start populating it. So. So these are a lot of the more common tools that are the command line tools. Info shows local info. Ring shows information about the cluster as a whole. CS stats show column family stats. And I'm going to have outputs of all these so we can discuss them in a little bit. TP stats show thread pool stats. And I didn't get into the staged event-driven architecture. And I don't know if I will have time to. Node tool net stats actually shows if you're doing a repair, it'll show you like what SS tables are streaming between nodes, and you can sort of monitor that. And node tool drain, which is actually, I know in the mailing list there was a little discussion about the utility of it, but it actually flushes MIM tables to SS tables on disk, and then stops accepting writes, so it kind of turns the node off and flushes everything to disk, which actually makes shutdowns a little bit nicer, because you don't have to read the commit log when you come back up, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. So this is what, and this is, I think, on one of my staging or test nodes.
This is what node tool info looks like. You've got the token and whether it's active and how big the stuff in it is and how long it's been up in the heap. Yeah, that's pretty old because it's actually a 16 gigabyte heap. This is what the ring looks like. What's really nice is you can see what cluster and or what data center and what rack it's in, which I'm not really properly utilizing the rack awareness, but I'm using the data center awareness. And you can see like the distribution of keys and who owns what and just basic informational stuff. And I bet almost everyone here has already done all these commands. This is TP stats, and I spend a lot of time when I'm doing node work. I'll just run watch on this and let it reload every once in a while. Because you can see exactly what's happening on the cluster or on that node at the moment. In this case, I've got like one active read and then three that are pending that are being set up. You're in trouble if you've got a lot of pending of anything. You might need to kick the node at that point. Column family stats, this is an example of like what our yielding column will look like. This is like 6 months old in our test environment. But you can see the size, the latency, you can see the read count. All sorts of wonderful stats that you'll probably be grabbing out of JMX or something like that and graphing, and that Ops Center might actually expose directly for you. Here's the histogram, which you sort of like a stereogram. You kind of got to look at it for a minute and then like defocus your eyes to understand what's going on. But it shows like a distribution of values, and you can spend some time with that. It's actually saved me a couple times. So backups. We actually don't do any backups because we only need 3 days of data in our cluster. And if we lose a little bit, it's a reasonably inexpensive process to recalculate some of those recommendations. But I have tested and played with them and I use them for a while. You can just do a node tool snapshot and then you can do a clear snapshot to clear it. And all it does is make a hard link and a subdirectory underneath the column family. You can do a cluster-wide snapshot, which is just cluster tool, which I think that's the only command cluster tool has, and clear global snapshot. Does the same thing. And to restore, stop the node, clear the commit logs, and if you zap the database files in the key space directory, copy the snapshot over, bring it up, and then it'll take a little while for the node to sort of sort itself out and for your file system cache to build back up and stuff like that for performance to get really good again. This is sort of the shutdown best practice, and there was a back and forth in the mailing list about this. Cassandra's crash-safe. You can pull the plug, and it's fine. You won't lose anything. But it's actually, if you want to decrease the amount of time it takes for you to bring your node back up, so it doesn't have to read the commit log, you can stop gossip. So all the other nodes thinks it's down. You can then stop thrift so that anyone writing to it can't. And then you can do a drain. You just stop it from there. And that saves a little bit of time on startup, especially when you're doing rolling upgrades. And let's let Ed know how much we appreciate rolling upgrades. You're my favorite. All right, so rolling upgrades actually are one of the absolute fantastic operational must-haves in any distributed system, and it's one of my favorite features because it went so smoothly when I did it. I had no problems. I was giddy like a schoolgirl. Don't imagine that. So what you do on each node, one by one, is you shut down kind of in the previous slide, so you don't have any like commit logs or anything sitting around that you need to restart on. You remove the old jars, RPMs, debs, whatever packaging, however you're deploying your stuff, and it'll leave your data there, don't worry. You're not gonna delete your data when you do a yum erase Apache-Cassandra. You have the new jars and you start it up and you do that through all of them. And the old nodes will talk to the new nodes and it'll be, harmonious and wonderful. Once they're all up, but before you run repair or do any sort of intensive stuff, you want to do a scrub, which Jonathan talked about earlier. And it's practically a compaction without compacting. It rebuilds all the SS tables. Puts them back together so that they're all kind of up to date and nice and new and shiny. And then you can actually start running repairs. It's kind of expensive like running a major compaction. And then after that, you run repair and you're pretty much good. So, hey, look at that. What happened? I'm done. So now I can actually answer questions. Cool. Who's got questions? What's up?
Why are you doing a snapshot when you are?
I'm just paranoid. Why are you doing a snapshot before an upgrade? I'm paranoid.
I'll snapshot everything. Yeah, I'm an ops guy, right?
Yeah.
What about communication? You said you have a 7 node cluster, 1 data center. What's your recommended
communication? We actually have a, and he's asking, I've got a 7 node cluster in New York and LA, 14 total. What's the recommendation for a replication factor? It really depends on what your threshold for data is, and there's actually a whole lot that goes into deciding that. We have a replication factor of 2, so we have 1 copy of data in New York and 1 copy of data in LA. I've considered. Yeah. I mean, like the data we're putting in there is easily, it's easy to recalculate it. It's not. It's not expensive to do so. You know, it's just a bit of a drag if you have to. So, you know, if we lose a node and it becomes totally bad, well, we'll bring the node back up and it'll replicate back over from LA. But we've only got like 80 to 90 gigs per node. So it's not that big of a deal. And actually, what I would might want to do, rather than having Cassandra do that, is actually what I'll tend to do is stop it, copy the SS tables that I need over, and then bring it back up and then run a repair. That can be faster in some cases, depending on how big the data is. But you know, if we wanted to increase our reads, we could bump ourselves up to 4, so we'd have 2 copies in both data centers if we were having read bottlenecks. So you know, the more replicas, the better it is to read. They actually have the dynamic snitch, which actually is really nice because it routes around degraded nodes and does all sorts of things for me, which is why I love Cassandra. It does most of my job for me. I did it per node because it's the first time I did it, and right. I'm a paranoid ops guy. I'm sorry, I'm really bad about that. Does Cassandra have a way of running scrub automatically for me, or using cluster SSH or something like that? No, I don't think Ops Center has that yet either, but they're working on it. But you could do it through cluster SSH or any other sort of like fabric or something like that. I don't know. I could probably do it through Chef. I chefified most of my upgrade, but it was the first time I did it, so I wanted to be as manual as possible.
Can you speak to performance side effects compacting has?
Yeah, can I speak to performance side effects that compacting has? Yeah, it does have side effects. with the current state of compaction, or the previous state, and I'm going to try out the hotness that is the leveled compaction as soon as I upgrade. You know, you needed twice as much space, because if you had 1 million keys in 5 SS tables and you wanted to put 1 million keys in 1 SS table, you had to build that new SS table, then move over to it. So, and while that's happening, it's occupying resources, it's limiting what Cassandra can be doing at that point in time. But it's actually in point 8, they actually have a threshold, like a throughput of, like, I think it's like, they'd mentioned it was like 16 megabits per second. Or megabytes per second that it can rebuild it. So that actually depends on if you want to just get it done and pull the Band-Aid. I upped it for myself. I think since version 0.5 or something, we don't have as many problems as we did with compactions and performance issues. What's up? Well, they're all coordinator nodes. Yeah, it's passing it through, right? Am I right, Jake? It's passing it, yeah. So that was one of our problems. I mentioned earlier the connection pooling setup that we have in Hector right now is that we're only using 3 of our 7 nodes in New York. And so those first 3 nodes were like weirdly loaded as they were routing all of these different requests. And I'd be like, wait, what's going on here? Well, then I come to find out that we're only talking to 3 of them. So, I mean, yeah, so it's actually funneling them through that, yeah. So it's actually a best practice to do it across as many as you can. So.
Okay. So let's just say your coordinator node, whichever one you're talking to, goes down mid process. That's just a failure, right? Like from the client's perspective.
Yeah.
Now let's just say you have a local quorum set up on your
The operation of the write?
Yeah.
I don't know, Jake. Did you hear that? The question was, if you're writing in like quorum or something like that,
local
quorum, let's say, in one data center, and you lose a node, that operation fails, right? The coordinator node that you're writing to. That's what I thought. Let me repeat that. If you didn't have a local quorum, if the node went down, then the operation would fail. Like, that makes sense. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I mean, if locally you have enough to make a quorum while that node goes down, then you'd be able to work with it. I got 3 minutes? All right, so I thought he was raising his hands. I thought he had a question. Way back there. What's up? I'm sorry, repeat that. Oh yeah, well it's not necessarily a difficulty, it's just, yeah. I mean, we use Brocade for our network infrastructure, and we've got two stacks, and it's all gigabit. And we use active passive or active failover bonding. So we really don't blow out network on Cassandra because we're spreading our writes across at least three of them. And we're doing bulk loading like as part of an hourly process or on demand.
So for the LAN, like, you know,
Yeah. I mean, all our loading is done in New York and then eventually replicates over to LA. How do I monitor network throughput? Through Nagios. I get an alert if a node is utilizing whatever percent of a threshold, which I don't get that alert a lot, which is really nice. All right, so 2 more minutes. Anyone else? All right, quickie.
So about the network, how chatty is gossip?
Chatty enough that I don't notice it. I imagine the bigger and bigger your cluster. How chatty is gossip is the question. I got to keep doing that. I don't really notice it. I don't have any problems with it. I don't see a need to separate it. But if you're doing tests where you're spawning 288 nodes or something like that, maybe a good idea. Like, I've never measured that. We have a pretty simple setup, you know. So, all right. So I think that's about it for me. But before I finish, I think we need to let Ed know. This is so craven and horrible that I'm asking for this. But let's give Ed a round of applause for sitting through this.